Hello friends, this is Bhupati. In this video we are going to see about ORI framework features. We will see everything in detail, what all the states are present in ORI framework and the conditions is used to move the bot across different states. Okay, now let us go to the video. Before we see the ORI framework, let us see the terminology framework. What is a framework? Framework is a template or platform to develop the software applications. Okay, now your question comes to our mind, whether do we really need a framework? Can I not complete my project without any framework structure? Okay, consider a situation when a client approaches you to automate a simple task like downloading a file and saving it to a particular folder. You can do it quickly without any complexity, correct? When the same client approaches you with a document of 100 pages to automate their entire process, then there are many concerns to be addressed while starting such a big automation projects, like where will you keep the config files, from which function or XAML you are going to read that config file, at which stage your automation going to start, and how the exception is going to be handled, because robust exception handling is very much important for automation process. And can I retry if any system exception occurred in the automation process? When bot should stop processing the job, or can I stop the bot if something goes wrong or if it is not executing the cases as per expectation? Like this, there are many concerns to be addressed before we start a automation project. If the automation tool you are working on having a framework template to handle all the set points, then you no need to worry about anything. You can concentrate on business requirement and understanding the project. UiPath designed a framework to handle all the above points, and we call it as ORI framework. So UiPath ORI framework, let us go and start looking what is in ORI framework. So as I explained, ORI framework is a template designed to help the RPA developers to create a standard project structure for UiPath automation process, and the template is designed using state machine layout. It contains all the best practices like exception handling, retry mechanism, ability to stop the bot, and much more is there. You will see everything in detail. Concepts you should aware of before learning ORI framework is, this is very much important, that is state machines and how it works, and arguments, dictionary, exception handling concepts, introduction to orchestrator and orchestrator queue, and data table activities. If you are not aware of these topics, I have given links in the description, because we have already covered all these topics in our channel. I kindly request you to go through the links before learning ORI framework. Particularly, you should be aware of what is state machine and how it works. Friends, this is the template of the downloaded ORI framework. You can see this is built using state machine layout, and there are four states are there: initialization state, get transaction data state, process transaction state, end process state. I have highlighted everything, and they have given annotations what actually what each state will do. Okay, now let us see each state, what actually each state will do. Let us see one by one. Initialization. In the initialization state, we initialize all the settings in the config file, or we load the values from orchestrator assets, and we open the applications we require for the bot to start processing. Config file is nothing but what all the constant values you use in the automation process, you can save that value in the config file, like exception messages or any other constant values to be used in a particular web page, then you can save that value in the config file. Why? Because means if a client comes up with a different value, then you no need to open the code and modify it. If you change it in config file, then it will automatically reflect in your code. Get transaction data state. In this state, bot fetches a queue item from the orchestrator queue and start processing the transaction. And in the same state only, we stop request is initiated when we give stop in UiPath orchestrator. Process transaction. In this state, bot process each transaction, and once the bot finishes a transaction, it can be either be a successful or failed transaction. After setting the transaction status, bot will pick up the next available transaction from queue and start processing. That is, In this transaction, what sets a transaction as successful or failed one in the orchestrator queue, and then picks up the next transaction. End process. This is the final state of ORI framework, and bot comes to this stage after processing all the transaction and log out the application, make the browser clean. Okay, even if any system exception occurs in the initial state also, it will come to the end state. We will see that in next slides. Friends, there are many variables are available in ORI framework. These transaction related variables are very important one, so I have highlighted this here. Transaction data, transaction item, transaction number. Transaction data, it points to the collection of data to be processed by the bot. For example, I have given here on data table all these three rows of data, that is MPID, grade, position, zone, everything collectively known as transaction data. Transaction item, every single row here denotes a transaction item. Transaction number is the current transaction number bot is processing. For example, if bot is processing the first row item, then the transaction number is 1. If the bot picks up the next transaction, that is second row, then transaction number is 2. This is what transaction number. Transaction data need not to be a data table. It can be collection of any data, like collection of Excel files, collection of notepads, collection of Word files, or any collection of data. That is, we say transaction data. Friends, this is the variables used in ORI framework. So we already saw the highlighted variables, transaction item. This is of data type, queue item variable type, transaction number, integer, and then config is the dictionary. This config is dictionary is usually defined to load the config values from Excel file. We define this config dictionary in the initialization stage, because only while initialization stage we read the constant values. Transaction data, this is a just collection of data we saw. Retry number, this retry number integer value will be used if the bot is about to retry any system exception. This transaction number and retry number is initialized with default value in ORI framework. I will show that while opening ORI framework template. Transaction fields and transaction IDs mainly used for logging purpose, that is to display any additional values of transaction data. For example, if you have 4 rows, then you can take additional column value, that is grade, position in transaction field 1 and field 2. This is just for logging purpose. Now we will check possibilities of bot control from initialization state. Friends, if you look at the ORI framework, this is the ORI framework template we saw, correct? First state is initialization state. Okay, this is what I am going to explain it here. What are the possibilities for the bot to move from initialization state? It can go to either get transaction data state or end process state. Now let us go to the ORI framework template. If you see initialize from the initialization state, there are two conditions are possible. Based on one condition, it can go to the end process state, and based on another condition, it can go to the get transaction data state. You can see the one condition is system exception, another condition is successful. Now let us see what the condition is defined for these two, that is system exception and successful scenario. If it is success, then system exception is not nothing, because if system exception is not nothing, then success means system exception nothing. For successful scenario, system exception is nothing, then it will go to the get transaction data state. Because what actually denotes a success in initialization stage, friends? If there is no system exception, then only we can consider it as a successful scenario. So if system exception is nothing, then it bot will move to the get transaction data state. If there is any exception at the initialization stage, then bot will go to the end process. So this system exception is not nothing. You can see the destination goes to the end process. So there are two conditions are possible for the bot to move from the init stage, That is, one, it can reach the get transaction data state if it is successful, or it may reach the end process state if there is any system exception. Okay, friends, here you can notice there is no any retry mechanism included in RE framework in init stage if any system exception occurs. Now let us go to the next state. Possibilities of abort control from get transaction state. Now let us go and check the RE framework template. Now if you look at the get transaction data state, you can see based on one condition it goes to the end process, from get transaction data to end process, and based on another condition it moves to the process transaction state. Now let us check these two conditions. First condition check, friends, new transaction from get transaction state, what will reach the process transaction state if there is any transaction is there to be processed, that is new transaction. You can see the transition as new transaction, and here I have highlighted for the condition for new transaction. Friends, transaction item we already saw, that is any single entity of transaction data is called as transaction item. If transaction item is not nothing, then there is some transaction to process, so bot will go to the destination process transaction state. This is a condition for new transaction. Now no data. No data means there is no transaction item to process. That is, if transaction item is nothing, then it will go to the destination end process. So another condition to move the bot from get transaction state to end state is system exception. If you look at the catch block of the get transaction state, they have used transaction item is nothing, so the bot automatically moves the control to end state, that I will explain when we check the RE framework template. Now this is a transaction data variable information I explained. Now we can see transaction item is not nothing, it moves to process transaction. If transaction item is nothing, then it moves to the end process. Now we look at the next state. Possibilities of bot control from process transaction state. Now let us again go back to the RE framework template. From the process transaction state, it goes back to the get transaction data state. That is, if any business exception occurs, it goes back to the get transaction data state, and for any success scenario also it goes back to the get transaction data state, and if any system exception occurs, then the control goes to the initialization state. Let us see this in detail. Friends, as we saw in our RE framework template, from process transaction state there are three conditions for the bot to move the control to the another state. That is, if any system exception occurs, then bot moves to initialization state. And for business exception and success scenarios, for both these conditions, bot moves to the get transaction state. You can check the conditions I copied from RE framework template. That is, if system exception means if system exception is not nothing, then there is some system exception, so the destination is initialization. If business exception is not nothing, then it means there is some business exception, so the bot move the control to the destination get transaction data. For success, what actually defines a success in process transaction state? If system exception is nothing and business exception nothing, then we can consider it as a success. Then it will go to the get transaction data. In the initialization state, we consider success as if system exception is nothing. You can see in the init state, because we never initialized any business exception in the initialization state. Why? Because means business exception will come into picture only while processing the automation. So we will initialize the business exception only when our actual automation process starts. So here the success is defined as if system exception is nothing and business exception is nothing, then it is success scenario. Friends, here we need to understand why business exception and success condition, both for both these conditions bot moves to get transaction state. In RPA automation, if your bot is executing all the cases as per our expectation, then we can consider it as a success. In business exception also, bot is executing as per our expectation because business exception is defined by the client or business team. In case of system exception, we are sending the bot control to the initialization state. Why? Because when system exception might have occurred due to various reasons like page load issue, application slowness. If the application is reinitialized by closing all the opened windows or browsers, then it is more likely the system exception may not occur if the bot picks up the next transaction. That is the reason we are sending the bot to init state if any system exception occurs. Now we'll go to the end state process. In end process, there is only one section, entry. Entry section only is there. Usually state contains entry and exit section, but here end process only entry section is there. Here we can close the applications once the bots finished processing the automation. Friends, this is just a simple flow diagram I have drawn to help you understand easily about RE framework structure. Now let us go to the RE framework template. So there are four states is there: initialization, get transaction data state, process transaction, in process. I have drawn four states here. Initialization, get transaction data, process transaction state, end state. From the initialization state, let us see the where the control goes in RE framework. From the initialization, bot can either move to end process or it can reach get transaction data state. You can see if it is success, it reaches the get transaction data. If there is any failure, then it will reach the end state. Okay, what is actually success here? If system exception is nothing, then init stage is success. Okay. And I have also defined the conditions here. That is a condition for success, condition for new transaction data, system exception, business exception, no data. Okay, here if it is success, system exception is nothing. Why? Because means business exception will come into picture only when the your automation process starts. So in the init state, we initialize only system exception. If system exception nothing, we can consider it as success, then it will reach the get transaction data state. Now let us go back to the RE framework template. From the get transaction data state, it can either move to end process or it can either move to process transaction state. See, if there is no data to process the transaction or if any system exception occurs, then the control can move to end state. If there is any new transaction data, then it will reach the process transaction state. New transaction data, what is the condition for new transaction data? If transaction item is not nothing, then we can consider there is some transaction item is there to process. So bot will reach the process transaction state. From the process transaction state, it can either move to get transaction data or it can either move to init state. Now let us go back to the RE framework template. From the process transaction, see if business exception and success scenarios, it is coming to get transaction data state. If any system exception occurs, it is coming to init state to reinitialize applications and close the all the opened windows. So the system exception may not occur again when it processing the transaction. In this flow diagram, you can see if success and business exception occurs, now the flow goes back to the get transaction data, and if system exception occurs, then it goes to the initialization state, and then after processing transaction state, finally it reaches the end state. Okay friends, this is a simple flow diagram. Now we'll see what are the XAMLs present in the RE framework. In the init state, you can see init all settings.xaml. In this XAML only, we load values from Excel, that is the contact values, and then we load the values from assets and add the values to dictionary, that is config dictionary. Kill all process.xaml. In this XAML, we will kill all the applications to make the browser clean for running automation. Initallapplications.xaml. Here we open the applications we required for automation process that we do in initall application. In process transaction state, you can check process.xaml is there. This is the actual XAML where we implement our automation process. Set transaction status.xaml. Here we set the transaction status of a particular transaction item, that is whether it is a success or business exception, that we set in this XAML. Let me show you Orchestrator Studio. Here you can see the status, that is if it is failed, it will be failed and it will mark as whether it is business exception or application exception. That is if a process is failed, it can be due to two reasons, either due to business exception it can fail or application exception, that it will be captured here. And if it is business exception, you can see the exception message, whether it is business exception or system exception, you can see the message here, what is the reason for the failure. Even for application exception, if you are given any reason, see selector issue has occurred and the bot failed in identifying an UI element. If it is success, you can check the status as successful, that is bot successfully completed the automation process. This status is actually set in this XAML, set transaction status.xaml. Take screenshot and close all application. This is also used in this XAML, set transaction status, because if any system exception occurs, then bot takes that screenshot so that it will be helpful for developers to verify at what place actually system exception has occurred. And close all applications. If any system exception occurred, then bot will close all the opened applications. For this reason, these two XAML is used in set transaction status.xaml. In getTransactionData.xaml, we will get the transaction item from the orchestrator queue, and if any exception occurs in this XAML, then transaction item is condition is set to nothing and the bot moves to the end state. In the end process, we just close all applications, so we use close all application.xaml. Kill all process.xaml also required to kill any unnecessary process. Okay, now we will go to the next picture. Here you can see get transaction data and process transaction state. What actually means is from the get transaction data state, bot will move the transaction to process transaction. In this process transaction state, bot completes processing the data and moves back to the get transaction data state to check if any transaction item is there to process. If any transaction item is there, then again will control come back to the process transaction. This repeats until there is no transaction data to be processed in get transaction data state. Just to explain this, I have used this picture. Then we can see these queue items from orchestrator is executed in first in first out basis. That is, if four item you have uploaded to queue and the first item you uploaded is 111 invoice number and second is uploaded as 222, third one is 333, fourth one is 444, bot will execute in the same manner, that is 111, this is a transaction item 1, 222, this is a transaction item 2, and this one is a transaction item 3, 444 is a transaction item 4. And also keep a note of it, that is this first in first out basis is applicable so long as there is no priority set in the queue. If any priority is set, then it will not execute in first in first out basis. Now let us go back to the Aria Framework template. and explore the features of it in each and every state. I'll go to this video. This is a downloader RE framework template. You can see in the home screen, Robotic Enterprise Framework. If you click on it, you can download the Robotic Enterprise Framework template. Let us check what all the folders are there. The data, this is where you will save the config files. In data, you can see input. What is the input file for your automation process? You can save in input. And output, that is after processing your automation, after processing all the transaction data, if there is any report, output report, then it can be saved in output folder. This temporary folder is, if anything that you want temporarily to store, then you can use the temp folder. And you can see config file, this is where actually we save all the constant values we require. There's exception messages, delays, everything we set in this config file, so that we can load these config file values to dictionary and use it in RE framework. Okay, I'll go back to the studio. Next is the documentation. You can check the RE framework documentation. This is given in PDF format. Exception screenshot, if any system exception occurs, then bot captures that screenshot and save in this folder. Framework, in this framework folder we saw already what are the XAML included in RE framework, that is given here. There is init all application, all settings, get transaction data, so all the XAMLs are given here. And there is one more XAML, retry current transaction.xaml. Here actually we are incrementing the retry number, that I will explain while explaining set transaction status.xaml. Okay, this is the main. Now we will go to the init state. Let us click on the init state. You can check there is two sections are there, entry and exit section. Only in entry section our code will be there. Try catch block is included here. I have not included any code, friends. Just I have downloaded the RE framework template and explaining you. You can check only the first assign activity they have used is system exception nothing. And you can see the variables shown in the PowerPoint. That is transaction item, system exception. You can see this variable. Let me show in slide. These are variables I have shown in RE framework. This is what we are looking here. And I already said two variables are initialized, that is transaction number is initialized with the value 1 and retry number is initialized with the value 0. So if any retry, if system exception is retried, then this retry number will get incremented. This transaction number will get incremented when the bot picks each transaction item from the transaction data. Transaction data here given, they are given as a variable type data table, but it can be anything. Mostly it will be data table, so I have given system.data.data table. Okay, first they have said system exception is nothing. Friends, nothing keyword is a default data type. Okay, keyword represents the default value of the data type. So that's, they have just used as nothing. That means there is no system exception. If we check the catch block, you can see the system exception is set to exception. That is some exception has occurred and it is assigned to system exception variable. You can check the system exception variable here, system.exception. Friends, in init state, you can check only system exception is initialized to nothing. There is no business exception because business exception comes into the picture only in process stage. You can see in process transaction state, they have used business exception equal to nothing. Okay, so for initialization state, success means if system exception nothing, then it is a success for init state. And also you need to note why this condition is included in the init state. If first run, read local configuration file. Okay, why only during first run it should read? Because if you notice that In process transaction, if any system exception comes, bot control comes back to the init state. So if this condition is not included, what will happen? Every time the config value will be loaded, that is, it will take unnecessary time because the constant value remains same no matter how many transactions are bot processing. Okay, so if first run, what they have done, they have used a condition, that is, config is nothing. Config is a dictionary, so dictionary will be nothing only during first run. So based on that condition, they are initializing, they are loading the config values to config dictionary, that is, they are loading the values from this Excel to the dictionary in the form of key value pairs. For that reason, they are using initAllSettings.xml. If you open initAllSettings.xml, you can check import arguments, you can check the, they are passing the configuration Excel, and then they are passing the sheet name settings constant, and finally, after loading the config dictionary with key value pairs, they are returning using out config argument. If you look at the configuration Excel file, you can check the sheet names settings constant assets. This is, they are following, sending the value here. And if you open the workflow, they are loading all the row name, name and value as a key value pair to the dictionary. That is, whatever the name is there, it is dictionary key name, and whatever the value is there, it is a dictionary key value. All the, whatever the name value is there, it will be added to the dictionary in the form of key value pair. So it is happening in initAllSettings, and for assets also, it is also loading assets from orchestrator and adding to the config dictionary. After loading asset values and configuration values from Excel file, we are using add log field. This just nothing but a log message. So the message will be displayed in the execution log that I will show you. While explaining ORI framework with a real-time task, now I will show where actually you can see. If you click on Ctrl L, you can see log messages getting generated here. If you click on any execution log, so whatever the add log field you are giving, that message will get added here. We will see in detail later. So this is the init state. Now we'll check the get transaction data state. Friends, in get transaction data state only, they have used check stop signal. That is, if you give stop in orchestrator, then it will be collected in using in should stop boolean variable. If it is true, then what should happen? Bot needs to be stopped. How the bot can stop, friends? Only based on the condition transaction item must be nothing, then only bot will stop, correct? It will go to the end state process. Otherwise, the control will never reach end state process at all. So what they are doing means, if the stop signal is received, they are setting this should stop boolean variable to true and setting the transaction item to nothing. So once this condition is set, bot will go here to check if transaction item is nothing, then it will assume there is no data and it will go to the end process state. This is will happen if stop signal is given. If there is no stop signal, then it comes back to the get transaction data.xml. Friends, in this XAML, bot fetches the data from the orchestrator queue using get transaction item activity. Okay, this will fetch the single transaction item. After processing this transaction, again the control will come back here and will pick up the next transaction. We can give queue name here, and then transaction item is a queue item variable type. We are sending a transaction item out. Let us check what all the arguments passed from get transaction data. You can click on import arguments. You see transaction number. Transaction number is initialized with the value 1. This is in config. we are passing the config value, whatever the values we loaded in config dictionary, out transaction item, because transaction item needs to come from the get transaction data XAML, so it is given as out. And transaction fields also need to come from the get transaction data XAML, so all these values given as out. Input output transaction data, this is nothing but the collection of data. And now if you look at the get transaction data XAML, we read the transaction using get transaction item activity, and then we are checking if the out transaction item is not nothing, then there is some transaction to process. This is a optional step, because this transaction field 1, field 2 is mainly used to display the additional values of the transaction data in the log messages. So they are given here as this option. Okay. After processing get transaction data, what will go to the process transaction. In process transaction, they have set business exception equal to nothing, because only in process, that is only in the automation process we are doing, business exception can occur. So when process.xaml starts, they have set it to nothing. Process.xaml, this is our parent workflow of the automation process, because this is where our entire automation process is going to happen. Okay, now if you look at the catch block of the process transaction, they have said business exception equal to exception. This means some business exception has occurred, and they have stored it in exception variable. Here system exception equal to exception. Finally block. In the finally block, we use set transaction status.xaml. Using this XAML only, in orchestrator, we will set the status whether the particular transaction item is failed with business exception or it failed with application exception, and also we will give the suitable message why it failed. For example, if you click on this business exception, you can see invoice number not found in the Acme application. Like this, we can give message for why it failed with business exception. If it is application exception, you can view the details why it is failed. Some selector issues happen, so it is failed with the system exception. Now let us open this workflow. You can see three sequences are there: success, business exception, system exception. Success condition is met, that is if a business exception and system exception is nothing, then it is success. If it is met, then it is coming to this sequence and setting the transaction status as successful, and then adding log fields, that is what are the messages you require, you can add in log fields. Transaction status is success, transaction number, and the other transaction fields you can add, and then you can remove it. Otherwise, these log messages will show even after crossing this particular stage, that is whatever the next log messages, also same message will be displaying. So they are removing this using remove log field. Next is business exception. In this sequence, they are setting the transaction status, this error type business. They are giving a real reason, business exception dot message. Whatever the business exception message you are given, it will be captured here. And transaction item, for which transaction item you are marking as business exception. Again, they have used add transaction log fields and remove transaction log fields. Here, friends, if you remember, in the main variable pane, they have initialized the transaction number to default 1. Before bot picking up the next transaction, we need to increment the transaction number. That is happening here. If it is success and business exception, we are incrementing the transaction number 1. Here the retry number is 0. Why? Because means we won't retry for successful scenarios and business exception. And if it is system exception, let us open the sequence. Q retry, they have just used a boolean variable here. This is a if in transaction it is not nothing, and if the transaction item is of Q item variable type, then it will condition will become true. Here it is setting the status as failed, and error type is application exception. And also retry number, this number will get assigned if you have given retry number while creating the queue. For example, I'm just creating some test. You can see this auto retry. This is the default maximum number of retries given while creating the queue. You can give it as 2 or whatever the number you wish that RE framework needs to retry if system exception occurs, you can give here. So that many times it will retry. If you are not given anything, this retry number remains 0, and then retry current transaction. Here you can see condition: if maximum retry number given in the config file is greater than 0, condition is there. Let's go to the configuration file. You can see this maximum retry number. This must always be 0. Why? Because means whatever the, if you have used orchestrator queue in RE framework, then orchestrator queue retry will always override this value. That means you have given the value here 2, and in orchestrator you have given the value as 1, that is maximum number of retry. Then bot will retry only one time. So they have given a note here, it must be 0 if orchestrator queue is used. That is the condition here they have given. If maximum number retry number is greater than 0, it will go and retry will happen here. Otherwise it just increment the transaction number. Here after reaching maximum retry number, it will increment the transaction number. Whenever it is retrying, it goes to the else part and retry number will be incremented here. After completing the set transaction status, it takes screenshot, because now we are looking at the system exception. As I explained earlier, whenever system exception occurs, bot will take the screenshot and close all the applications. That is happening here. Happening closing all the applications, the control moves back to the init state. That is, after system exception, it goes to the init state. Again, it will reinitialize the application here and then continue the process. It will continue the process till the transaction item is set to nothing in the get transaction data. Once the transaction item set to nothing, it will reach the end process state and complete the framework instance. That is, it will close all the applications and will complete the process. Friends, hope you would have got the clear idea of RE framework. And there is another video I have uploaded, RE framework quiz, so that you can attend it. It will be easily understandable. If you like this video, subscribe and support, and share to your friends. Thank you.